Dames en heren. Het is net als vroeger op schoolreisje, dat kennelijk de achterbank altijd het leukst is. Maar er zijn hiervoor ook nog plaatsen, in principe. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the PBL Academy Lecture by Jason Shogren. It's an honor to have you in our midst on this hot day. We expect a few more people that can't reach the destination because of problems with the train, but they will hopefully arrive. In the meantime, as I see, most of you have been wise and dressed up in a way that fits to the temperatures, but to those that think that a tie is needed, I would encourage them to rethink that. Heat is something you want to get rid of, after all. Don't concentrate in your bodies. The tradition of PBL Academy lectures is one in which we organize mid-sized seminars like this one with as single most important goal to the idea that we constantly have to find new forms in which the science can speak to policymakers, but also, very importantly, we as researchers can learn from what is important for policymakers and their practice. It's, I think, very out-fashioned and old-fashioned and out of date to think of it as a single directional policymakers understanding the struggle that they are engaged in trying to improve basically on our livelihoods. And I know that today we're going to learn a great deal because we are also going to be encouraged to think about defaults, to think about getting rid of certain defaults, to think about opportunities to extend the range of instruments that we can use in trying to improve on our environmental qualities. And that for sure is something we desperately need. We come from a tradition and at PBL very much to speak to the policymaking world from a biophysical perspective. So pointing out the problems in the environment in natural science terms. So CO2, NOx, and then thresholds. And of course then there was a difference between reality and what was ideal. And ideal was also something we gained from science and the sciences of health. But that language obviously assumed a great deal on the part of policymakers. They had to understand it and had to be able to act upon it. And I think today we are in a period in which we realize that it is the in-between, the very different institutional relationships that we have that are probably holding the key to improving on our environmental qualities, to understand why it is so difficult. So limits to growth, I suppose, for those who were at kindergarten in 1972, is something that we've grown up with. And there's no use keep pointing out that there is a gap. What we have to do is to find ways, strategies, to close that gap and to improve on our livelihoods. And it is precisely in that broadly defined domain, I think, that this talk is going to be of much use to us, and I'm very much looking forward to it. Professor Shogren, who was here already for thesis defense earlier, so we have a double ticket, very efficient. I think the Dutch are always more efficient than others, and this is no exception, even to the extent that it's almost impolite. But nevertheless, I hope you still are looking forward to delivering this lecture to you, to us. You, professor at the University of Wyoming in the United States, the author of some 29 pages worth of academic articles and books. And I don't think there's any need to give a more elaborate introduction to you. because you're beyond introduction. You will introduce yourself in your talk, and I'm very much looking forward to you. So let us give you a warm welcome, Professor Shogan.
Let's see, I'm on. Can you hear me? How about in the back? Does it work pretty good? Professor voice loud enough? Okay, well, using the professor voice, I can see that the Dutch are no different than mine. Fill up the back rows first and leave the front ones empty. So what I'm going to talk about today is what I've done the last 30 years working on environmental policy and the interaction of behavior and institutions in that context. I'm trained as an economist. I went to the University of Wyoming, and if you've never been to Wyoming, we have 500,000 people in the whole place. I live in a town of about 100 people. It has 4 bars. It has 3 bands. It's quite a place. Dan has been there, and he survived. And so I come from it from a very practical type standpoint. I'm trained as an economist. I spent a year in the White House working on the Kyoto Protocol as their senior environmental economist in the Council of Economic Advisors, which was my wake-up call to the policy process, because I came in as a good academic thinking, well, of course, I will tell you the truth, and you will implement it. And then afterwards, I realized, yeah, that was sort of naive. And since then, I've been much more appreciative to the process as to actually become an elected public official. So I spent a decade on our school board, elected to handle crazy parents and everybody else. And I've been appointed to several other positions in this interface, because the way I think about it, if you're a scientist, you experiment on other people. And if you're a mad scientist, you experiment on yourself. And so part of the process has been actually to learn how I end up making decisions when the pressure's on in situations with budgets of millions of dollars. And then I realize I'm as good at withholding information as anybody else. I'm as good as dealing out information to make deals happen. I'm just as strategic as everybody I complained about that ever I dealt with. And only if it's not for self-preservation in the process. So this talk today is going to be a lot of that blending between science, policy, and dealing with people who are not economists and not necessarily shackled by the ball and chain of opportunity cost. Okay, so economists are always talking about opportunity cost. The rest of the world are not. The rest of the world, I think, can a lot of times be summarized. Costs are regrettable, but by no means decisive. All right, if there's a target, we're going to do it. Okay, cost effectiveness is fine, but we have a target in mind and we're after it. So for me, my mindset for a long time has revolved around this. And if you've seen me talk, I've put this up here just to get myself squared away. In that the people I interact with typically have some sort of principle that they organize their thinking around. And economists for a long time have organized their thinking around the idea of choice inside active exchange institutions or markets. And environmental economists have spent most of their time worrying about missing markets, that if only we had markets, we could facilitate, you know, the movement of resources from low-valued uses to high-valued uses. And a lot of environmental economics has been in that interface of trying to use taxation or cap and trade to be able to create different policies. But once you get outside and you start working with ecologists or biologists or climatologists or any of the ologists that are not economists, markets are not their preferred organizing principle at all. It might be something on institutional rules, it might be something on biological rules, it might be something that myself I don't have a lot of or any expertise on, but yet they have their feet at the table as much as any economist. And when they start organizing problems in terms of giving policy advice, they're not bound by the same rules we are. They're not bound by the same ideas of trying to move the world into this model of exchange and facilitating exchange. They have other goals. And so I've tried to understand this as best I could. It's needless to say it's messy, and sometimes the results are better than others, and sometimes the modeling of the process falls apart, and sometimes I don't know exactly where I'm at when I'm trying to do this process, but that's okay. That doesn't bother me a whole lot. So if we wanted to define a couple of terms that we're going to use a lot here, if we think about environmental economics, it's using economic principles to sharpen environmental policy. And for a long time, that would be that intersection between markets and no markets. And behavioral economics, if you've had Richard Thaler here, you've known that it's trying to use psychological insight to sharpen economic principles. And I think what's interesting here, if you have something like behavioral environmental economics, you are trying to bring in good prices, right? Relative prices. And you're trying to bring in this notion of good citizens at the same time as good prices. And they're not necessarily completely stovepiped, you know, they're not separable. There can be spillover between the two. And if what you're trying to do is create markets or create things that are like markets, then behavioral economics has a lot to say about this. And for a long time, I tried to do my best to ignore behavioral economics. I did not want to go this route because I'm not a psychologist. I have a minor degree in psychology from 1980. So, you know, that pretty much makes me a pop psychologist at home, right? I mean, I watch Dr. Phil. I don't know if anybody's seen Dr. Phil. I mean, I can pull off some of that stuff. You're not a very nice guy, you know. Or the best one I learned is for your kids, well, that really doesn't seem like you. So I can try some of that sort of stuff. But in terms of psychology, I did not want to go someplace where I, you know, didn't necessarily, wasn't at the frontiers. But at the same time, I wanted to pull in what I could. So when we think about the economics and we think about behavioral economics, what we oftentimes get here is our econobot who's thinking in terms of rational ways, but it's not you personally. It's the agglomeration of all your decisions within the marketplace that we're extracting your best ideas and you're self-selecting and we got comparative advantage and all that sort of stuff. So even though it may be an econobot that we're modeling, we're not modeling you, so don't take it personally, okay? It's not all about you in this case. It's about the best of us trying to move this institution around, right? So rationality is a social idea, social construct in economics. And then as we move this way, we move into game theory, and we move into strategic behavior. Now the power of the institutions gets a little bit different, gets a little bit weaker. If we're up here, then it just arguably takes one rational person who can turn everybody into a money pump, and we can arbitrage. And if you're seemingly a little bit irrational, I can buy low and sell high to somebody else. And everything moves along like it works. But as we move over here to game theory, and we think about strategic interactions, typically what happens is the weakest player in the game, the least rational player, everybody has to drop down to that level. So in one sense, you got the market pushing things up towards efficiency and rationality. And in some cases, the game, it's pushing the opposite direction. It could end up, you know, in something like a prisoner's dilemma that you end up with the best outcome for the wrong reason. But, you know, that's a lot of wishful thinking. Till we push all the way over here to we think about the isolated individual. And when we're talking about psychology, a lot of times we have this isolated individual. And so how much and how far along this continuum are you comfortable in operating, right? I mean, how it's much easier to be over here because everybody's roped in and everybody's under control. It's messier to be over here because now you've got credible threats, reasonable beliefs, off-equilibrium paths. You start figuring out equilibrium. And then when you get over here, well, we're in the National Theater. I mean, they got whole disciplines devoted to Hamlet, right? I mean, that's all they do is study people standing on stage pondering life. And I don't know if economists have any great comparative advantage relative to Shakespeare, but certainly we can understand that along this continuum, we can't necessarily hop over here too and try to explain each and every individual, because we're trying to explain in a social context and a different social context than, say, something like Hamlet. So this continuum for me, I'm, you know, way comfortable being in here and in here, and then less comfortable being over by Hamlet, right? I mean, and then it becomes a question, if that's what you want to do, who do you want to read, economists or Shakespeare? And at that point, yeah, there's no competition, right? So the pragmatic question then is, if you're on that continuum and you're thinking about integrating these things, can they help ENR, environment, natural resource economics, provide more protection at less cost? If not, why not? If yes, what are these new policy tools? Can we predict things better? And by how much? And then the hardest question that I'll come back to several times is, if we're going to go down this route and we're going to think about nudging and we're going to think about incorporating all these different forms of social behavior as a policy measure, then the question is, what's the new baseline against which we're going to judge success and failure? Because when we had the Econobot, typically we say, if the winners win more than the losers lose, let's do it, right? But now if we get down to Hamlet, we're like, well, what did the winners win? And what did the losers lose? And how much do we incorporate this broader range of behavior to come up with a baseline to judge success? Because we can judge success in a partial equilibrium world and say, oh, that looks better. Oh, yeah, that looks better. But we can also get into these games of what we call whack-a-mole, right, where you get a hammer and you whack this mole down in the ground and another one pops up over here. And so trying to understand, adding in these different types of behavior, what we get, what we can judge success by, is, to me, the challenge. And I guess I would say it's easy to cherry-pick behavior that's in the tails and that seems to work. And then the question is, all right, well, what are the second degree effects? Or maybe they're even first order that we just haven't seen yet. So if we try to summarize some behavioral patterns that people have identified over the last 50 years in this field, it's that, well, you can read them. I mean, the big one is not liking losses, overweighing small chances of large probability events, right? Like lottery tickets are just a tax on the mathematically challenged, right? Because there's really no reason to buy a lottery ticket if you actually put probabilities and outcomes together into a simultaneous evaluation system. Think in bundles. The fact that I even had to write this one up here is kind of sad for economists, that we care about each other. But typically in our models, we're not really always caring for each other. We're looking for ourselves. And this last one, whether or not financial incentives or good prices are actually crowding out good citizenship, and that, or working the other way, or are they separable? In this realm of things, what we've looked at is the context of choice. And the one thing we've avoided as best we could for all these years is that we're allowing our preferences, our decision making, to be context independent. We have preferences that get thrown into a market, prices change, we react. Because once we start opening up preferences to be context specific, then we also have a whole set of issues about what most people have seen in terms of thinking fast and thinking slow, our gut reactions versus rational thinking, and what moves us into one of those versus the other, and based on all these different contexts. And if we can understand how that works, and we can understand again the baseline against which to judge it, we're all right. So here's, for me, what trying to look at behavioral underpinnings has done in terms of trying to think about environmental policy. So when I think about environmental policy, I kind of do it like an auto mechanic. All right, what's broken? What's at risk? Where's the conflict? Can we cooperate to solve it? If not, can I design an incentive system? And okay, how big of an incentive? What kind of, how do we value this change? And how do we think about all this in terms of poverty and prosperity? So I go through my checklist if I look at a problem. And before, I just had rational behavior here, and it was not an issue. We just, boom, we're done. We just walk through it. But now it's like we introduce a fiat or something, and nothing against fiats, but let's just say we throw one of them into the mix. And now I've got to understand how things are happening under this notion of bounded rationality, whether it's information processing skills or inability to absorb every bit, all the things Herbert Simon and followers have said for the last 50, 60 years. How does that affect our ability to understand what's broken in the environmental context? Or bounded willpower, all our self-control issues, you know. In one of the bars in Centennial where I live, it has the sign, free beer tomorrow. It fools most of us a few times, right? And we constantly go back due to this lack of willpower. But, you know, how does that affect things when we can't get our own capacity? Has anybody ever gone to the website stick.com, STICKK.com? So this is one of these things about control, where willpower, where you can give them your credit card, say you're going to run a marathon, you get a witness to verify it, and if you don't run the marathon, they will charge whatever you agree to, let's say $1,000, to something you hate. Right? So in the United States, if you're a good liberal, you know, it would be to reelect another Bush. Right? And so you're really going to run that marathon because you really don't, or if you're conservative, it's to the elect Hillary Clinton campaign, right? And you're really going to go out of your way as a commitment device to handle that problem. How does that kind of fit in for environmental stuff? Well, you can commit yourself to all sorts of things, you know, recycling, but it has to be monitorable and measurable, and you have to have a third party who can actually step in, like most parties. Bounded self-interest, that's just another way to say we care about other people. And once we start thinking about what are the conflicts and cooperations, how do we integrate all the work that Eleanor Ostrom has done in terms of collective and collective action in thinking about where it is we can make the biggest difference in terms of understanding how to get more environmental protection for less. And this last one I added, the unbounded emotions, because as we start doing behavioral economics, what we've done is open this Pandora's box of different emotional attitudes. And whether it's regret or disappointment or envy or guilt or lying, right? I opened up this box. You know, I come from good Scandinavian stock. My wife is Swedish. And I love her so much, I've almost told her. Okay? So I want that emotional box closed. All right? I mean, I am not willing to just fling it open and just, you know, just wear it out there. I mean, I might change my mind. Or maybe I'll get around to it. Or I want to say it when it really matters. Well, that's not most of the world, but that's the world of when we start thinking about sort of Homo economicus, we've constrained all those emotions. And so My big question is, why let one out at a time? I don't know if you can let one out at a time, right? I mean, if you got guilt aversion, aren't you averse to lying, and aren't you disappointed, and aren't you thinking about all the different things that you regret and all the different types of emotions? I don't know if you can let out one emotion at a time. It makes me nervous. And the thing of it is, once we let out more than one emotion at a time, the big problem then is, are they additive? Guilt, lying, suspicion. Or do they intermingle? And does being more guilty make you more lying averse? I don't know. See, I'm out of my ballywhack. But what it does say to me is that you can cherry pick here, and you can end up with a degree of freedom that will pick up some data, but that degree of freedom could be any one of these emotions. Unless you're very comfortable with it, or you can just say, this is my emotional air term that I just sweep away all this behavior, and I don't want to explain it, kind of like what we've done for total value in terms of non-market valuation. Use values, passive use values, whatever, we'll just call it value. Perhaps the way we could handle it is thinking about what does it mean when we're trying to understand why environmental policy or why the market's not working by some form of emotional adder, but you want to pinpoint it, that's up to you. So the policy choice, the way I've thought about it, is to think about this notion of a money pump as one extreme of arbitraging people for their inconsistent choices, not making any value judgments. If you prefer less money to more, that's fine, that's your call. But if I turn you into a money pump so that I can buy low, make a switch, sell you something high, and you fall for it, all right, that's fine. But the market's working as if you were rational, versus this whole idea of nudges and pushing people along. I mean, I'm not an advocate of nudge, so I'm pretty much an agnostic on this. I just follow along what people do. I don't have a stake in this. I don't have a company, and I don't own stick.com. You know, I'm just curious as to whether or not this is going to work. Right? So, you know, the choice is to integrate this behavioral data into models and use nudges to induce people to do the right thing. Right? Good citizens. Versus this idea of driving out these behavioral biases with money pumps and then use incentives to get the prices right. And again, there's not one or the other, but just to make the point, let's just say we're thinking about one or the other. We've typically focused on this one, but this one now, with all the different groups that are forming, you know, the nudge unit in the UK, and there's one sort of in the US now that's coming out of all places, the Department of Agriculture. Apparently, they just let them run wild over there. And they're trying to convince other people in the U.S. government to do it. I don't know, is there a Dutch nudge unit here? Behavioral? Yep. And so, the question, I guess, is this right thing is a big part of the question. You know, your right thing might not be my right thing, but maybe who's ever in power has the right thing established, and that's their baseline. Versus getting relative prices right. And talking with a journalist this morning, he kept saying, well, you keep saying, get the prices right. And I said, well, yeah, I'm an economist. What did you want me to say? And he said, well, what about good citizens? I said, yeah, I'm all for good citizens. But I don't know if it's my job as an economist to create good citizens. There's other institutions to do that. You know, that's why we have churches. That's why we have synagogues. That's why we have a broader array of institutions that are designed to do that. If economists are supposed to create good citizens, okay, then you got to help me define what a good citizen is in this context. And interacting now with the policymakers becomes fundamental, because good citizen means sea changes in how we do things. Like today, even, you know, I had my bottle of water and I drank it and I didn't throw it in the garbage. I knew at the Free University there would be a recycling bin somewhere if I looked hard enough. And I found it. And I thought, man, that is so not me. Right? But I was like, wow, I did it. I was like, and then I jumped in my SUV and drove to the airport and flew back home, right? So I'm trying to be a good citizen, but you got to help me define it. Okay, so the deeper questions then is, can you use these money pump ideas in environmental policy, or are you pushing it too far? Can nudges, I want to say, play a substantive role? Because what we want is for these nudges to stick, not just a transitory shock, right? So right now we're doing a lot on energy use, where you get your bill and you get your use relative to your neighbor's. And there is a little bit of a shock there where you go, oh man, I just use way too much energy. Or water. Oh wow, I should not water my lawn, or I should do this. And the question is whether it's persistent, and whether those persistent shocks in your behavior can be sustained for a long time. And that's the whole idea of supercharging these incentives by getting you aware of what you're doing relative to other people. And these commitment devices, we talked about those in terms of the stick.com. Subtle changes to the default options, opt-in and opt-out is probably still the biggest success in the nudges. You know, the carbon offsets that you can buy on British Airways, but you have to opt into them. I haven't seen British Airways have you opt out of them yet. And I think it's KL, they got them too, but you have to opt in. Right, in terms of buying a carbon offset, I'd be interested in some field experiment where you could actually get the airlines to randomize it, opt in, opt out, to see how big of a difference it would actually make. And in terms of organ donation, it makes a huge, huge difference whether you opt in or opt out in terms of donating organs on your demise. The whole norm-based messaging, goal setting, and this is the work Paul Ferreiro, Mike Price, lots of people, the O-Power people in the U.S., attempting to get you to think about social norms and react to them, a shock to them. But then the question is, how persistent, how long-formed do you readapt a different way? Yeah, that's just what I said. And the point being that a lot of this stuff, for very little investment, you can get an idea of how big the nudge impact really is. And what I've noticed looking at the literature, for the most part, 70% of the papers I've seen, 80% of the papers I've seen, these nudges have a statistically significant impact. But then again, they have like a million variables that they're estimating these equations. So chances are something's going to be significant when you got a million variables, right, in your data set. The question then is, how big of an economic change is in them? And most, a lot of these huge, huge programs have 0.03% change in energy use. They're not huge, right? They're statistically significant. They might be economically significant if you add them all up, but on the individual level, they're not as big as we had hoped. And so the complication for me has been this baseline against judging success and failure. And I think this is still where the battle lines are drawn in my mind. We have a baseline, rational behavior, random behavior, right? Every science has an upper and lower baseline. And the question is, where do we draw the new upper baseline on behavior? Because for a good 200 years, the only thing we were averse to in economics was risk. After the Bernoulli's cousins got in there and added some curvature to utility functions, we are averse to risk. And then Kahneman and Tversky came along, and Ellsberg back in the 60s and 70s, and then pretty soon we were averse to losses and ambiguity. And those make sense. Loss aversion, okay, I don't really want to lose what I have, okay, I treat it differently than trying to get a gain. I can kind of see that. Ambiguity aversion, people really don't like ambiguous risks. They're the things that scare them the most. When I was in the White House, I worked with Janet Yellen. She was my principal, and I kept trying to convince her on climate change, and she kept ignoring me. And until I got to the point where I said, well, the Gulf Stream could shift. And then her ears perked up, and she says, what's the chance of that? And I said, And she's like, wow, we need to do something. And I was like, okay, I got my principal to pay attention by giving him the big ambiguity, you know. And she was like, that's just not enough information. I don't like this. And that was how I thought, well, okay, this behavioral econ stuff can work, even on an interpersonal level, you know. But now, I'm not sure what we're averse to anymore. We're averse to everything. I mean, I don't even know if I want to get out of bed when I think about everything, how averse I am to everything. And so as you go through, I was just trying to do this the other day. I went out and did a Google Scholar search on aversions, and I started documenting them. And I think I got up to 40 different types of aversions. 50, yeah, we're a mess, right? I mean, we do need Dr. Phil. We need something, because out of this, we need a baseline. It has to be something. And this is ideally where, you know, a place like PBL and a place like the universities start whittling out, okay, here are the four aversions we need to, this is our new baseline. This is it. We can live with this for another 200 years. Versus the 50 of them out there, because now, and this is the way I think about it, you've got preferences like a pinwheel, which gives you demand curves like pinwheels, which gives you cost-benefit analysis like pinwheels, which gives you policies like pinwheels, and here we are. Why do we need economists for that? We already do that. I mean, that's part of the process. And so maybe rational choice theory is too restrictive. Maybe, you know, it's like Goldilocks' bed. It's too small. Throwing in all these aversions, okay, maybe it's too big, right? Maybe it's a little too big. And the question that we've tried to do, again, thinking about this, is how do you whittle down those sets of emotions, those sets of aversions, so that we don't get stuck in this situation where, you know, when you hold up the policy pinwheel, there you are. Right? To judge failure and success. I found this one yesterday. I was reading this book, or the day before, and I paraphrased it a little bit. Irrational people are not irrational if you accept their reasoning. And absolutely. But, I mean, we can't have 100 baselines, or can we? Right? So that's the trick, I think. Focus on this aversion explosion, or focus on the institutions that actually allow you to scrunch down on the number of emotions that are viable in whatever situation you're dealing with. And this is what I've tried to do most of my career. I've tried to avoid this, and I've tried to look at that, and then I've tried to ask myself, is that institution reasonable? Am I asking too much? Is that institution incredible in the sense that I've just dreamed it up myself? Is that institution valid, and can I move it to the field? And since I started, a lot of, you know, the work in the lab and everything has been moving out to the field, which is great. With this idea that as we move out to the field, the institutions are the ones that we do have to deal with, and let's see how they actually work. And I know I'm going to go through four examples pretty quick, and the details aren't all there. Some of them are older than others, but they're the things that I've done, looking at coordination, rationality, but let's just go through them. So the agglomeration bonus is the first one. And here I was just trying to agglomerate habitat that was broken up and fragmented across private landowners. In Wyoming, we have 50-50, private-public, but we also have a checkerboard. And that checkerboard was because we needed, like, people. So we ran the railroad across Wyoming, and we gave every other section to the railroad company. So now we have this public-private, public-private. It does look like a checkerboard. And so what we are trying to do there is reunite this habitat based on thinking about our Endangered Species Act. And I thought, well, do I try to get, you know, the folks in Wyoming to be good citizens, or can I give them the right incentives without worrying about good citizens? So here's the basic goal. We've got four landowners. We got one target. We want them to retire that land in the middle, like if you were trying to have grizzly bear habitat, okay, or wolf habitat, or songbird habitat. And we're going to pay you a bonus for every acre that you retire that touches another acre. All right, so I don't have to rely on anybody being a good citizen. I just have to give you an incentive to cuddle up to your neighbor, whether you like him or her or not, okay, because you're getting paid extra for doing it. And so we created this game, 10 by 10. It's got a lot of strategies, and it has about 5,000 to 6,000 Nash equilibria. Right? And so only one of them is the optimal. There's a lot of them to figure out. And these are four players. They can send one message to each other. So the very first thing we did, we gave them no subsidy and said, just retire your land. And they kind of had a pattern like this where they're retiring their cheaper land. Makes sense. Sometimes yes, sometimes no. Okay, that's with no subsidy, just command and control. Then we paid them a subsidy per acre. And it looked like this, kind of the same sort of pattern. Then we introduced the agglomeration bonus. You get paid for being contingent to another acre. So I didn't need them to be good citizens to have good citizen-like behavior. I gave them the right incentives. In this case, it worked. In this case, it's not a money pump per se, but it's the right prices rather than, right, good prices rather than good citizenship got the policy that we wanted. And we've tried this different ways. Different people are doing it now. I'm glad to see experiments being done here. They're doing them in Scotland, this whole agglomeration bonus. The Germans are doing it for butterflies. The Finns are doing it for forestry. There's lots and lots of activity. So when we started doing these a decade ago, people always come and say, yeah, I want to do this. And I was like, yeah, let's go do this. And then they never come back to me. They go find somebody else. Not that I took it personally, but I was just glad they went and found somebody else. And it's actually being implemented different places around the world. And it was based on a pretty simple experimental design. Now, what we're trying to do is make the land prices endogenous to make it a little more complicated, and how do we introduce that part of it? Rationality spillovers. Here's where we're trying to convince folks who don't have markets as their organizing principle why markets matter so much. So this, briefly, most people prefer a safe bet to a risky bet, but when they come to value it, they value the risky bet more than the safe bet, because that risky bet has a high payoff and a low probability. And when you disconnect them, you look at the high payoff, why you buy a lottery ticket, right? And so this is the old preference reversal issue. And what we're interested in, whether money pumps can realign preferences and valuations so we don't have this pinwheel of policy, and whether or not that learned behavior in a market will spill over to non-market choices. And that interests me because now we spend some time in markets, some time in non-markets, and if markets are conditioning us to think like rational people and we take that to non-market situations, me as an economist, I'm happier doing my modeling than saying, oh yeah, okay, this assumption is not that bad. So briefly, what we have is trials and rounds. We have the number of preference reversals. So people get a lottery, they're asked to rank them and then value them. So about 40% of the time they reverse their preferences by saying, I like the safe bet, and I'm putting a higher value on the risky bet. And then we introduce arbitrage here in round six, and you can see we kind of scrubbed out that behavior towards the end. We removed it. And that's what we expect. I mean, it's boom markets. And people generally like more money to less, even though it's not always the case, but typically. And we didn't make any kind of value judgment on them. We just showed them what happened and let them make up their mind. But while we did that, we also in parallel asked them non-market valuation questions. And we asked them hypothetical questions about So first we started with a real lottery, then we started with a hypothetical lottery, then we started with a hypothetical wildlife lottery set in Yellowstone National Park. And all that arbitrage that was happening in the other graph was not happening here. Okay? The change in reversal rates was, but I was not arbitraging anyone here. I was arbitraging you in this environment and then asking you to act, make a choice in this other environment. Now, what did I do? I did not try to explain preference reversals. I used that institution to scrub them out of your behavior. Now you can say, oh man, that's harsh. Every time you make a mistake, boom, I'm right on top of you. With a money pump, just whack. And then you're like, oh, yeah. Anytime you make a mistake. So then you can say, oh yeah, okay, maybe they don't get arbitraged all the time. Well, that's okay. I think that's still a valid point, but it works. I've now made the world more like the model, which should make you nervous, right? Because I've taken an institution and made the world more like the model. I've made these folks rational. But that brought me back to my toolkit that I'm used to working with, and I was content. Okay, now I like this one that Paul Slovic, who found this preference reversal thing, he said, well, this is a harsh penalty revealing our defensive posture about the reversal phenomenon. I was like, no, that's we're not defensive. That's our job, you know, is to introduce behavior in a market and then see what happens. So I still think we got a little ways to go in convincing each other which is better, a money pump or a nudge. But in this case, a money pump worked just fine. This last one, preference elicitation under oath, where now we've got missing markets and we've got no markets, and we're working with social psychologists to try to figure out this notion of what real commitment is. If we're an economist, real economic commitment typically is putting your money where your mouth is, no hypothetical behavior, no tell me something, it's actual, what did you do? Revealed preferences over stated preferences, even though we've done stated preferences a long time. And so we wanted to try to figure out how you create real commitment without real exchange. And if you look at the social psychology theory of commitment theory, essentially you're using a device as a commitment device. And, you know, they've run different experiments, foot-in-the-door experiments, or they've run the one that you can try when you leave here today. It's before you go panhandling in Amsterdam or anywhere, ask someone for the time first. Then ask them for a euro, and you'll double your chances of getting a euro because they've already committed to be the type of person to give away something for free, the time. And if you get the time out of them, you can get a euro out of them more often than not, even me. I do it in Denver all the time. And people might just give me it because, you know, they're like, no, just get away, please. You know, I mean, I look typically homeless, but, you know, that could be part of it. So we're trying to use this oath as a commitment device to try to get people to tell the truth. Okay. And we're running this at the Sorbonne with students there in Paris, and the idea was to adopt a dolphin. And the notion was we wanted a real adopt a dolphin, so you can do the worldwide fund for nature and you can adopt a dolphin. And we worked with them, and we wanted to do it for real and for hypothetical. Okay? And typically 25 euros gets you a dolphin. And who doesn't like dolphins? Right? We figured this was pretty safe. I mean, if the World Wild Fund picked dolphins, it must be like because everybody likes dolphins. Them and seals, baby seals. Okay, so here's the results. Here are the bids on this axis, and here is the distribution, cumulative distribution. And you can see the hypothetical bids start here, and they cluster way up at the top. Not surprising, because it's hypothetical. We violated the budget constraint. People can say whatever they want. In the real experiments, you can see people are clustering down here at 0 and 1 euro, 40%. That is just so unrealistic. people like dolphins. I mean, come on. You're at the Sorbonne and you're 20% of you are paying zero for a dolphin? I don't believe it. So what have we done here in terms of the real experiment? We violated their participation constraint to a certain extent. We have not done anything to get them to participate. We've done this with baseball cards, and you can also see the same trend with baseball cards. 60% of the people, I mean, it would be like, you know, the thing we did was in the U.S. would be like going to Portugal and saying, how much are you willing to pay for a Ronaldo soccer shirt? And everybody says zero. It's like, no way. That's just not true. Somehow we've not done the experiment right. So then we asked them to sign an oath that just said, I solemnly swear to be honest. And the blue one, we got all these people off the zeros, and we got all these people off the high end. We got them to actually look like a demand curve by just asking them a simple nudge. I guess that's a nudge. But I think an oath is more than a nudge. I mean, when do we use oaths? When we take a public office, when we get married, when we, well, like today was a pretty big oath with the, the whole ceremony and the speech and the signings. And I mean, that's a huge, and well, no, he had to swear an oath to the Republic of Science. It's huge. So it worked, though, in terms of getting people to pay attention to the process at hand. Now have I sort of smudged the great name of oath by using it for environmental policy? Maybe. Maybe if we have to take an oath for everything, it really doesn't mean much anymore. And now we're going to have super oaths. Right? We're going to have two oaths when you get married, or you, I don't know. So if this type of nudge worked to get better estimates of demand, I'm willing to live with it. I don't know how long it'll stick, how long it'll persist. We've tried these oath experiments on lots of different types of behavior. We get movement every time, not as much as perhaps we want, but we get movement every time in the right direction that we would consider, whether it's being cooperative or it's being telling lies or not telling lies or thinking longer before you tell a lie. The oath is, I mean, we're fascinated by it. I don't know if the rest of the world is, but to me, it's a simple way to do it. It's been replicated out in the field in China and Sweden. And in China, everybody... They're running out of time. Yeah, well, you guys are subtle here. Wow. That's a nudge. Yeah, that was what I would definitely call a nudge. If it falls on top of me, it's a money pump. Well, anyway, the Chinese and the Swedes acted differently. The Swedes, there was no difference, and the Chinese actually lowered their demand. And I asked the authors why, and they're like, I don't know. I said, well, see, now that's the problem with economics doing psychology. We got to do better than I don't know, right? I mean, we either bring the psychologists on board, work with them just like we work with the ecologists, but I don't know is not acceptable, right? I mean, I may know because, like I said, you know, I'm hooked into that Scandinavian world of, you know. I'm gonna skip this one. I think we're pragmatic. I think we'll use what works, and I think we've done a big service by trying to integrate all these other disciplines into our story, whether it's ecology or psychology or climatology. You know. And I believe we can create good incentives and we can create good citizens. Yeah, that's some more spooky about. I believe we can give advice on how to get significant economic changes, but I think we have to be real careful about how we would do nudges, just like we should be careful about how we do ecology without ecologists involved, right? I mean, we have to be able to and be willing, if we're going to do the nudge work, to spend the little extra money to bring psychologists into the team so we're not doing pop psychology from 50 years ago or reinventing the wheels or, you know. That's absolutely key. And I think, you know, I keep harping on the baseline because we need a baseline. And it has to be reasonable and it has to make sense in order for us to give you guys advice that you can sell to the people you have to make the decisions for. So if I was going to leave you with a couple ideas, this behavioral failure, is it another form of market failure? The fact that we're having to make decisions outside of markets, if we drug all that behavior into a market, would it persist and would it survive? Well, I think that one, yeah, I'm not so sure anymore that that's just another form of market failure. We get lots of asset bubbles. We get lots of different problems with savings. The new behavioral baseline is one we've talked about. This one, number three, we haven't talked about, but it's important for an economist when they think about partial equilibrium, things in isolation versus general equilibrium, everything as a system. Because what I'm worried about is if we have an externality and we have loss aversion and we have some Pigouvian tax that's aimed at the externality but not the loss aversion, can we make things worse off? Right? Or if we have some nudge aimed at loss aversion but not the externality, can we accentuate the externality? So in terms of the idea of a second best problem is if you got two things that are broken, fixing one of them doesn't guarantee that things are going to get better if you end up accentuating the negative on the second one, right? That's the theory of second best. And the world's just full of second best. But this sort of cross second best, we haven't really sorted out yet. I know one guy looked at adverse selection by trying to correct an externality in the health industry with using a nudge, and it backfired. It's almost like the double dividend premium, right? There's no free lunch here. And so that's one that we can sort out. Other people's opinions? Well, if you're a fan of John Elster, he's like, no, you guys just give up. Everything's way too complex. There is no baseline. Herb Gintis, evolutionary game theory is where he sees this new baseline coming from. Bob Sugden says, it don't matter because we're going to redefine the baseline. You can have all the crazy incoherent preferences you want as long as you react in one systematic way. We can get away with redefining the baseline with inconsistent preferences. Ariel Rubinstein, he's doubtful about this all. And then the new rising star is Chetty, and his view is very pragmatic. Use what works, throw out what doesn't. Okay. That sounds like a centennial kind of guy. Even if he's at Harvard, he would fit into our town of 100 people and 4 bars. I mean, if that's the rule, that would work. Okay? So, from my perspective, you know, I wish I had a silver bullet, but I don't. What I have is my Venn diagram and my willingness to jump into the Venn diagram and then try to swim around and then pop back out and talk to people about it. I survived another adventure into the Venn diagram, right? But at the same time, you know, the people that I've worked with and the students that I've had have taken a lot of this a lot further and have gone, been very, made major contributions in trying to disentangle this while I'm floating around over here in my happy little world, okay? And it seems doable. But you just have to be committed to be willing to figure out that blend between good prices and good citizens. And if you're willing to do that, I think there's no shortage of ways to actually make things happen. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you so much for your lecture, which was very clear and full of insights and full of humor, which is a lovely combination. Before I hand over to the floor, and I'm sure there are many questions, that new baseline came back and back and back, and that clearly bothers you. You want to at least give some more depth to that point of view. But in between, you often said that, you know, China is not Sweden and Sweden is not the U.S. You are based on collaboration between economists and psychologists. Is it an idea to extend your research team to also include anthropologists and people who know about culture? And if that is a yes, then perhaps we shouldn't go for a universal behavioral science, but for a contextualized baseline.
Good question. A contextualized baseline is where we're headed. And then my question is, with the contextual baseline, is it going to be an infinite set of contexts, or can we bring it down to, oh, wow. Can we, I've never seen one of those. So can we bring the contextual baseline down to something that's manageable? Right, and if not, then everything is context dependent, and then the whole idea of did the winners win more than the losers lose? Well, yeah, we've lost our yardstick. I've lost the yardstick.
But are you afraid for a contextualized approach?
Only because I will be obsolete. In the sense that I have spent 30 years with one baseline, right?
Okay.
And so that's my baseline. And so if somebody's going to come up with a replacement baseline, that better be good. Okay. I'm like one of those grumpy old, you know, dock workers. If you're going to come up with a new way to move from A to B, it better be good. Mm-hmm. And so if you're telling me, well, there's like lots of different ways to move from A to B, I don't want to know. I want to know how to get from A to B, and I want to be able to defend it. And if it's raining, okay, maybe I'll listen to you. Maybe mm-hmm. I don't want to slip down this thing and break my back, right? If the context is something that I can, that is exogenous, that is something that shocks to the system and I can make it. But if the context is endogenous to the system, now the ability to pick the path is infinite. And now I'm not sure anymore how to judge what works and what doesn't if I get from A to B, the mm-hmm. best way.
Okay. Well, but if the context is the context in which a policymaker operates,
yep,
then for that policymaker it's very useful knowledge,
yes.
Right?
Yeah. If they want to give me the, okay. if they want to define the context for me, okay. then I can work
okay.
with it.
Okay. Well, one more question. We are all, of course, very much looking forward to what will come out of Paris. The climate conference in December this year. And we've now just been told a couple of days ago that China is seriously pledging a carbon intensity reduction. And obviously this pledging is a crucial way for leaders to commit but not sort of sign. They don't really sign up to something, but they pledge that they will do something, and in our imperfect world, that is the way we get ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Would you, from your science, have a suggestion how we could make these pledges perhaps be more in the middle of these two lines, so that because we obviously at PBL constantly measuring these pledges, but there is always a discrepancy between what is pledged and what is really being done. Is there a behavioral insight that we could convey to the conference of parties?
Can you make them take an oath?
publicly. Yeah, that would be your suggestion. I was thinking. Okay.
Well, I mean, if you got a promise, you know, if I promise to buy you a beer later and I don't show up, you won't really be mad. If I make a pledge, yeah. If I make an oath, right. Yeah, you'd be pretty
make
mad.
Make it publicly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Make yeah. it transparent.
Yeah, just move it up to the oath category.
Oh, okay. If somebody can tweet that to Christine Figueres, then perhaps we have made the world a better place. In my left hand, I have, which is called a catch box, which, you know, I suppose it's fun for a couple of months and then everybody knows about it and it's no longer fun. But I assume for some of you it's new, it's a microphone, and I can throw it at you. But you can also stand up and ask me to throw it at you, and then you have the right, of course, to raise a question. So this is the microphone. Is there anybody, in other words, with a question to Professor Shogren? Well, here you go. And speak into the black bit.
The black bit, okay. I'm Jaco Schuurkamp. I work for the city of The Hague, and we're also very much in a political environment. So everything I do is very contextual. We have to redefine a lot of things. We had an economic crisis. We have several political crises. Now we have a lot of small political parties, mm-hmm. and they're all trying to win their fight. So there's hardly any consensus to cooperation. They're all trying to pick their little fights. And the thing I'm wondering about, would it be to redefine economics in a sense? I heard you talking about externalities, and I've been reading about evolutional economy, which has a more inclusive approach to economics, like the weather is not an externality. If you want to define a road, it should be in the question. So redefining economics in the sense that of bringing externalities within the puzzle, would that change the game?
Yeah, well, that's what we have tried to do for the last 50 years in terms of environmental economics, is to make sure that externalities are right in the middle of the game. Now, you can't get away from them. Here they are. Here are the externalities. Deal with them. The fact that now most all the major universities around the world have an environmental economist. They've replaced their agriculture economist with an environmental economist. Makes that clear. There's no avoiding externalities anymore in economics. We can try, but you know, the idea of the closed square economy, it persists, but I mean, it's less easy to get away with it anymore.
Thank you. My name is Nora. I work at PBL here. And I'm also an economist by training. And I remember still when I was studying economics, I studied at two different universities. It was very, very mainstream. And we heard barely anything of all of what you just talked about, which I think is very interesting. So I'm wondering, since you just brought up universities and you're a professor yourself, do you think that has been changing? Do you think in mainstream economics, as it is taught at universities, it's really these things are really taken into account? And it's overall just broadening in terms of horizon. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, maybe that's why I'm at Wyoming. You know, I mean, they just put me out there in the middle of nowhere and let me do my thing. And 30 years ago, I would have said that, yeah, that what we're doing was a branch or a twig on the branch of this tree, and we're out here. But as I said, now environmental economics, resource economics, is in just about all the major departments. Behavioral economics is just about all in the major departments. Behavioral economics, and you get these waves, you know, fads and things crashing that, but I don't think any of them are going anywhere. Do we get listened to as often as we'd like? Well, sort of yes, sort of no. It's more of a question of continuing to make the point that you got to include externalities, and then you got to know how people are going to react to them in order for to do good policy. And as long as the policymakers are willing to listen to that, people will listen to us. I was on the state of Wyoming's Environmental Policy Council, which is the governor of our state appoints a citizens board, and we actually set environmental policy. And so in that sense, they couldn't not listen to me, because I had control. Well, not me, the board. I had 1/7 control. And so does it mean every economics department is going to give us or give this its due? No. No, it'll still be a long, it'll be a struggle. That's why you got to work with the other disciplines, especially the natural sciences, to get leverage. I mean, I still have the fight in Wyoming with my dean about how environmental should we be in this department. He goes, I don't want you to be a specialty. And I said, how can the globe be a specialty? You know, it's climate change. It's the whole world. How is this a specialty other than staying alive as a specialty? And he's like, well, you know, we want to promote entrepreneurship. And I'm like, sure, green entrepreneurship, whatever that is, let's figure it out and let's promote it in this context. But it's...
I think you would have an ally in environmental philosophy, right? Or economic philosophy even, because it's the premise of economic thinking that has to be rethought if you take the environment seriously.
Well, we're trying to maximize well-being, broadly defined, not just monetary well-being. So as long as we're willing to think about what well-being means to you and this and, you know, rational context, yeah, I can measure it. It doesn't just have to all be in dollars.
Pretty philosophical. Okay, gentlemen, this is going to be a challenge. You're a good catcher.
I've got it. Thank you. My name is Anjo Travaille. I'm a policy advisor mainly related to sustainability, and I normally use neuroscience as the way I work. I have two questions. The first one is, the picture on the background, is that Wyoming?
Yeah, could be.
Could be.
Could
okay.
Be.
Sorry, you feel a little bit familiar here then. The second one is, do you think that neuroscience might come up with your new baseline because it includes everything that has to do with self-perseverance and chances for reproduction? So if you make one line out of that, that would be your new baseline and could help you predict behavior.
Well, sort of the evolutionary game theory approach, going right back to biology as destiny. And so as an economist, that makes us nervous to think biology is destiny without some kind of environmental interaction or, you know, nature-nurture kind of argument. But if you're going to take it all the way back to neuroscience and chemicals associated with it, it would define a very different baseline.
Including brain and using fMRI for predicting behavior.
There is neuroeconomics out there, and those are not cheap experiments. And so the question is, you know, given sample sizes that they've done over the years, how generalizable are the patterns that they're finding? And that's going to just take time because its sample sizes are just small.
Hi, I'm Ruth, and I'm almost finished with my studies in social psychology. And when I started my studies, I always thought, like, why don't law students or economics students also learn this stuff? But now I'm almost finished. And I've got one question about the dolphins. And because I was wondering if people do an oath, then I think they're also, like, they know that there's something else expected. And people always want to give the right answer. So did you consider that when doing the experiment?
That's exactly what we wanted, right? We wanted to give them the oath so that they would do the right answer. They would tell us the truth was the right answer. And so we did in two steps. Before we did the dolphins, we did it where we actually controlled what the truth was, okay, in terms of what your payoff would be. And then we tested it an auction that was designed to get you to tell the truth. It's called a second price auction. You're the high bidder, but you pay the second highest price, so you have no incentive to overstate or understate. You have just incentive to tell the truth. And so we ran those experiments, and we found that the one with the oath got people to tell the truth the most out of all the different ones. Real no oath, hypothetical no oath, real with an oath. That was even worse. Mm-hmm. All right. So, yeah, we did take that into consideration and how we tried to measure what we would define as the truth, the true demand curve. Then we moved it to dolphins, where I don't know how much you want to pay for a dolphin, but I give you this oath to get you to ideally tell me the truth, your best value that you have in your head. No strategy, no zeros, no breaking the budget constraint. I mean...
Yes. Yeah, what I'm saying is that maybe an oath would lead me to give not the true answer, because I know that something else is expected than being like...
Oh, so the oath crowded out the truth.
Yes.
I'm not saying that everybody in Paris who takes an oath tells the truth 100% of the time. You know, I can't say that. But I'm trying to condition you to be the type of person who would. And whether I fail or not is, you know, that's for replication.
Okay.
My name is Mulder, and I'm a commercial market researcher. So my job is get people addicted to buying brands and products, right, in emotional ways. One of the problems is the definition of economic value with economists is very limited. You mentioned that you had children. Mm-hmm. What is the economic rationality of having your children?
The value I get, the genetics I pass along.
Yeah, there you are giving the answer. So there's the genes you're passing on. These are the lines of value to the person, value to the family, value to the group, mm-hmm, value to the gene pool of your ethnic mm-hmm tribes.
Yep,
and that gives me inspiration for what baselines are of for people's.
But remember now, economics is not just finance. Economics is not just business. It's not just commerce. It's trying to create value through trade. That's how I define it, right? Value created through trade. And value can be defined as broadly as you want. It doesn't have to be. We just happen to put everything in dollars. But I've spent 30 years valuing dolphins or grizzly bears and polar bears and children's safety, you know. But in so doing, I try to find a common metric, which is dollars or euros. Maybe that's the mistake. Maybe they should be in different metrics. But, you know, I'm still willing to try to put them into one metric.
Well,
okay.
Davos Hoestel University. I would like to ask the Chetty question, pragmatic, right? So the one most successful nudge that we know is the opt-in, opt-out, right? For donations of organs, it's an opt-in system is almost, maybe 10%. If it's opt-out, it's 90% signing up for their organ donations. And so I always wonder, what is the impact of this for environmental policy, right? Because if we can mileage this in the environment, it would really work very, very well. The thing is that this decision is just a one-off thing, right? You just decide, this is a decision you just make, and there's, the permanency is just that you're never going to think back, and you just picked your choice, and that's it. So I think that one of the things that when you think about human behavior, we think about rationality, et cetera, but we also just, we have habits, right? We just have habits. And most of the environmental activities that we do, the pollution stuff, is because we just have the habit of going by car, we have the habit of not separating our waste flows, et cetera. So now if you have your list of things we can tweak, right? The loss aversion that also works well, and the other tweaks. Are there, if I can choose from this set of tweaks that I can or buttons I can push, which ones would be most effective in getting people to get new habits that are better for the environment, thus solving the permanency problem?
What's your timeline? I mean, do you want it 2 decades from now? You want it 3 decades from now? Do you want it tomorrow? What's your target timeline? If you want 3 decades from now, we can start a social movement. And we have legalized gay marriage in the United States. That only took a century. We have 2 states that sell marijuana. Right? That only took another century. We can't smoke inside of a bar in Wyoming. Are you kidding me? That took 50 years. So, yeah, if you want that big kind of sea change to get good citizens out of it, how fast do you want to get there versus getting good prices as a way to move you to be good citizens, right? So if you don't want smoking, triple the price of cigarettes or 10 times the price, eventually good citizens will be, well, we don't want smoking bars. So I think, depending on what you want, you know, fast action or long-lasting things. What I worry about some of the nudge business is it's transitory to start, and we're going to overreact that it didn't work when maybe there's a much longer trend that we're not observing. Right.
Push you a bit more, because so one of the things, so in many countries, including the Netherlands, we had this system of you buy a bottle of Coke and you have to pay the extra money, right, and you get it back up and bring back your bottle. It's highly effective, right? And the question is, why is it? Because it's just a few cents per bottle, right? 25 euro cents for a 1.5 liter bottle. And I think it's sort of a loss aversion thing, right? So you gave money away, and now you have this bottle. And if you throw the bottle away, you basically throw away your. It's just 25 cents, but it used to be mine, right? So is that an example of where loss aversion can sort of help? Would that be an example of loss aversion that actually changes behavior and makes behavior more effective compared to the homo economicus prediction that you would just throw away the bottle because it's too far to walk, right?
I can buy that.
Okay.
Sure. I can buy that. I mean, yeah, you've got 25 of my cents. I want it back. I can buy that. I don't know if I call it loss aversion or stubbornness, but, you know.
Depends on where you are.
Yeah.
Hi, Jetske Bauma, also with the PBL. Thanks for a very inspiring lecture, a lot to chew on. I wondered with the baseline story, because I it's also something to chew on. I can see never know with these type of microphones. I guess my question is, I can see the academic relevance, but in terms of policy advice and designing more effective policy instruments, how crucial is it then? Because if we're looking cost-effectiveness analysis and you want to improve the effectiveness, which might be in terms of hectares of conservation area, I know all the issues there that you have to wonder how that is improving welfare or not, but still, I wondered if you could dwell.
Well, if it's cost-effectiveness, then you've already picked the target. The baseline is defined. We're attempting this, and now we just want to figure out a cost-effective way to get it. So the baseline hasn't moved in that sense. In that, the baseline hasn't. You've set the baseline by separating out the target, and the target's not endogenous anymore. And so in that case, the question is, well, you've proposed policy X. Is that the most cost-effective way? Or you can now try policy Y with a nudge and see if that's more cost-effective. So you could try good prices versus good citizens and see which one gets you there. But your target's set. Right? If the target's endogenous, then it becomes trickier because now, depending on which one you choose, you might have a new target at the end of it. And that's what makes me nervous, so I'd, okay.
André Knotner, Scientific Council for Government Policy. A bit following up with your question, speaking about good citizens and good policy, it's also very interesting and maybe quite urgent to think about good policy making. Mm-hmm. All the behavioral issues that are contextual there, the checks and balances for policymakers, the difficulty to use a long-term perspective, the pressure to do short-term scoring and political rewarding, which is not often on the long-term design focused. So what can we learn from the behavioral perspective in that context?
The commitment devices. And it becomes
so not
down
just the citizens, but the policymakers and the politicians.
Then it comes down to, I think, the behavioral insight there is the commitment device and whether you can commit internally or domestically or whether you do need these supranational outfits that pledge to do something where the commitment device now is one layer up. Right, and unless you can make them self-enforcing and self-committing, I can't see a country necessarily going to stick.com and saying, if we don't hit this target, we're going to give $100 billion to Vietnam. Right? I mean, but that's the kind of commitment device. Yeah. That would be the behavioral insight.
You have to do that in the context of democracy. However,
yeah,
probably, but you know much more about this than I do, but is there enough scientific interest for the checks and balances and behavioral determinants in that area? Because I think there's more studies on the behavioral incentives and nudging focused on citizens rather than the knowledge we have on how policymakers are influenced and how we could improve that.
You know, the one guy who might have written about this already is Cass Sunstein. He's written a book called Simpler with the R crossed out, which was his time in the White House as head of OIRA, which is like the bottleneck in the White House. So any policy that comes through the government has to go through this little bottleneck, which is him and his staff. And that book is all about documenting how much money they saved by shoving behavioral tactics back on policymakers and different agencies and saying, have you thought about using it like this? So if you get that book called Simple, Cass Sunstein, that's probably the best source of somebody actually in the middle of it, keeping a diary and documenting. And, you know, he claims he saves the U.S. $75 billion and I'll take it. That sounds good. Yeah.
Name is Aart de Zeeuw. Hi, Jason. Long time no see. I was wondering what is happening in economics, maybe not so much as borrowing from psychology or other behavioral sciences, but we just noticed at some point that we were wrong about human behavior. We developed all the theory with simple utility structures and later on with game theory, but when we went into experiments, things didn't work out. And so we had to change our settings, and we are now sort of in a stage that we have better understanding on human behavior. But what I would like to ask you is, what does it mean for our advice on policy, more specifically on environmental policy? Because you said on several occasions that usually economists would give the advice to get the prices right. And we feel comfortable, although it was based on that simple framework, it worked to a certain extent. But we're not 100% sure that this is the best way to do it, right? We still wonder whether this crowds out under force of motivation, whether we can do better. We develop all these ideas about nudging and about other behavioral aspects. But it hasn't led to conclusions on policy advice yet, in my view. For example, all these things that are cooked up are all sort of little experiments, like when you put a little note in a hotel room that, you know, about towels and so it works. You gave the example in the electricity bill, so if you sort of give a notice there that you are really using much more energy than your neighbors, apparently people are reducing the energy. But to take that for example, if the policy is to reduce energy use, and of course we can argue about it, it's the right policy or not, but let's take it as an example, the traditional economic advice would be to sort of increase the tax, right? Now, an alternative advice can be to put these notes in the electricity bill. So where are we? What would be your advice in such a case?
Yeah. Thanks, Art. Appreciate that. You know, I've seen moral suasion and job owning, and I've seen it work, and I've seen it fail. And it, oftentimes, the messenger is as important as the message. And so if you don't want to worry about the messenger, then you change the prices. If you think you have a good messenger who can consistently deliver a good message, go with it. It works. I mean, people, you know, we've been drinking Coca-Cola for hundreds of years now, right? A good message presented simply will stick. And good ideas that are presented simply will kick. And as long as you can do that, I have no problem with using nudges or moral suasion or information. It's when you're trying to provide information that's muddled or this side, that side, it's like you're providing them no information at all. I mean, we've done experiments on irradiated meat, right? So we auctioned off irradiated sandwiches, or nuclear meat, if you want to call it that. Right, and we gave people good information about it, you know, no more pathogens. We gave people bad information about it. You're going to grow two heads. You're going to be, you know. And then we gave another group both sets of information, and it was as if we gave them nothing good. They just saw the bad stuff, loss aversion, whatever you want to call it. That's what they focused on. But that was for irradiated meat. We did the same thing for GMO foods. And again, it's like we never gave them any good information. It was boom, they all leaned towards the negative. And, you know, if our policy making is based on plan for the worst, hope for the best, and that's the message you're sending, it's as good as any. And framing works in policy making, yeah. If you got 1,000 people who could die, what's better? Saving 600 of them or letting 400 die? Which policy are you in favor of? Right? Most people are in favor of saving 600. I'd never let 400 people die. Wait, yeah, they're the same thing. So, yeah, that's the old Kahneman-Tversky thing. I don't have a silver bullet. It's going to be context dependent and depends on what your time frame is. You want to change now or you want to change in 50 years? How significant do you want it to last?
Is there anybody in the audience who has a case? I mean, struggling with the application of behavioral insights in a policymaking case? Because you can now get free advice. That's actually quite rare. You're not on a consultancy fee here. So, anybody with a case? Think about it. And in the meantime, we take your question.
So my question is about the oats, the effectiveness of oats.
Yeah.
Well, my name is Charles Nusser. I'm from Tilburg University. So you mentioned that promises are somewhat effective and pledges more effective and oats even more effective.
Well, that's my working hypothesis right now. Yeah.
Okay. So that in that case, what I'd like to just kind of your sense about what makes an oath effective and what would make it even more effective. So if you go to this, you know, your ranking, you know, if I kind of extend your ranking of promises, pledges, oaths, and what more is out here? So is, a written oath, written and signed oath, more effective than a verbal oath, or does the text of the oath matter? I just want to get your sense of, you know, what would be a really effective type of oath or the next step?
What's the next step? I mean, what's your target, I guess? Different oaths have evolved over the years for different targets. So if you become a citizen in the U.S., we would all stand up and take an oath together, right? It wouldn't be an individual pledge. It would all be together. Oaths in weddings, and they're all with, you know, witnesses all sitting right there versus, you know, an oath in court. I think we just sort of have just tapped the surface on what it means to make a real commitment in an economic context for this type of world. The social psychologist, Robert Vincent Joulet, has been in D.C. They've been thinking about this a lot longer. But in our applications, we've tried different types of oaths. We've done collective oaths, which have failed miserably. We've done individual oaths that have worked wonderfully, and then we did the same experiment with a collective oath, and it all fell apart. We've had collective oaths that have worked and individual ones that have failed. Do I have a good theory for you yet? No, I don't. I don't. But, I mean, if you watch Game of Thrones, blood oaths seem to be pretty big. Right? I mean, that's a pretty big one. The Mennonites, is anybody a Mennonite here? Right? They refuse to take oaths because they never lie. And so if they go to court, they refuse to take an oath if they're called on to testify. So they've already committed. It's fascinating to me, yeah. So, I just feel like we're just sitting at the tip of the iceberg to understand commitment in these situations.
Sounds like a good PhD program to me. No? Yeah. But, get a good grant on that, differentiating systems of oath. We are moving towards the conclusion of this session, and I'm just checking who is desperate apart from Henk. Anybody? So then, Henk, it seems as if you have the right of the last question. Here you go.
That's always nice to have the last question, and also a case for you. I'm leading a project on scenarios for nature in Europe. And within nature policy, there is this movement of putting a price on nature. You have to work on that by yourself. So economizing nature. While on the other side, we see that people very much go for the intrinsic value of nature. In a recent research, which was funded by the EU, 200 leaders for nature from businesses, governments, and civil organizations were asked, so why did you do this project for nature? And intriguingly, it was not the economic pricing for nature, but it was childhood experiences without parents. So it's a kind of a nudge with a long delay, of course. So I was wondering if you could reflect on this issue of nature policy going to more economic pricing, whereas civil society looks to go for more another direction.
Okay, so if I rephrase that slightly to say, are economists getting in the way by trying to price out nature?
Something like that.
Something like more aggressive. Something more U.S.-based here. Are we getting in your way of, we're going to do the right thing anyway, and by trying to do pricing, we're actually crowding out your childhood memories or why you actually did it. Valid question. And there is evidence of definitely prices crowding out good intentions. There's some evidence of prices being complementary. In this case, I am trying to think right now if we have any really good, maybe Dan knows, empirical examples of environmental crowding out. I've got some theory that I can show you. Yes, we can crowd it out or we can crowd it in, but I can't think of a good study right now of environmental pricing crowding out good environmental behavior. It doesn't mean it doesn't exist. I just can't think of one.
But in the beginning, you said it's the money pump versus nudging. So it's a kind of a game. So I was really wondering, in this case of nature, which direction is this game going to? What can we expect in the future?
Oh, I don't think you're going to see anybody step back from trying to value ecosystem services. I think the demand is there from policymakers all around the globe. I think the economists are there to satisfy that demand, and I don't see that going away. It would be real interesting to actually look at that case study about the childhood memories and be able to actually figure out if that's true or not. You know, I mean, were they telling us the truth? Was it just something they said? I don't know.
Yeah, so it was just an example for a nudge. But I could imagine that in nature, conservation nudges could be used very much more than it's being used now.
Yeah, that's, you know, that's why when I was on the school board, we subsidized every trip for every kid who was going out in the woods. You know, if some teacher came in with a field trip to go hang out in the woods and climb a rock, we paid for it. You know, if they wanted to go to the art museum, well, we thought about it a little bit. But if they wanted to go skiing, they wanted to do whatever, we paid for it. We didn't even think twice about it. Because even in a conservative state like Wyoming, right, this is where Dick Cheney's from, we're not necessarily conserving on driving smaller cars, but we are conserving in the sort of old Teddy Roosevelt way of, I want to conserve nature because I want animals to run around, and if I want to shoot them, I will. And so we support that 100%, absolutely.
Just underlining the contextual in nature conservation. I think this is a good point to conclude this afternoon session. It's a double ticket, as I already said, your second big event today. Thank you very much, which was very enlightening and very stimulating. Lots, of course, to think about, in particular, in how can we find our own examples in the Netherlands, define them, and then have them studied. I mean, it doesn't always have to come from the science towards the policy making. We may actually come up with something, and that may be inspirational for the academics. We have a little token of appreciation. It's a Waka Waka light. It's very innovative, and they sell it, buy one, give one. Oh. I think you may have done experiments that can explain whether that is commercially successful. Anyway, it's ethically very successful because by doing that, they have given away some hundred thousands of these lamps to people in need. Uh-huh. Thank you very much. It's a token of appreciation.
Appreciate it. Thank you very much.